الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعد اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. Tonight inshallah we will start a monthly series about stories from the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed many stories of the Quran that talk about things that happened in the past, previous messengers, previous nations, and the situations that occurred with them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ بِمَا أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ. We narrate to you the best stories in our revelation of this Qur'an. So if we look at the Qur'an, we see stories of prophets from the past, starting from Adam alayhi salam to some of the stories that happened with our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and many prophets in between. And there are prophets, of course, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not inform us about in the Qur'an as well. But the stories of the Qur'an are all beneficial. They're not just stories to enjoy for entertainment, no. Rather, they are stories for us to reflect upon and to learn from. And we see the benefit when we read the Qur'an and we read these stories. We can take lessons and we can take benefit from every story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the Qur'an. And this is included in reflecting upon the Qur'an as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتْدَبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. This book we have revealed and it is blessed so that the people may reflect on its ayat and so that it may serve as a reminder for the people of understanding. So the stories of the Qur'an are there for us to reflect upon so that we may gain understanding. The first story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about in the Qur'an is the story of the creation of the father of mankind, the first human being, and that is our father, Adam alayhi salam. Before the creation of Adam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the heavens, and He created the earth, and He created the angels, and He created the jinn, and He created other things as well. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala informed the angels that He had ordained to create a new creation, and that is the human being, to inhabit the earth and to benefit from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on the earth and to enjoy the benefits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on the earth, to eat from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed to grow on the earth and to live their lives on the earth, the angels were surprised. And they feared that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was creating this new creation, the human being, because of some deficiency in them. They feared that because of some fault in them or some deficiency in them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was creating this new creation to inhabit the earth. So they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءِ وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. They asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are you going to place on the earth those who will corrupt it, cause corruption on the earth, and they will shed each other's blood while we say your praises and we worship you all the time? And they didn't ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this question in order to question His judgment. No, rather they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this to alleviate their own concerns. Like we said, they were worried that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was creating this new creation because of some deficiency in them. So they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not to question the decision or the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, never. The malaika would never do this. The angels don't do like this. The angels obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They never disobey Him and they do what they are commanded. So they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this question, not to question His judgment, but to alleviate their own concerns and to clear the thoughts that they had in their minds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them with an answer that sufficed and that made them comfortable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to them, قَالَ إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Simple. He said, I know that which you do not know. I'm doing this because I know what you do not know. So the malaika were happy with this answer. They didn't try to continue questioning him. They realized that yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has complete knowledge. He knows what He is doing. And He didn't give us complete knowledge. So we don't know the big picture. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing this because of some wisdom that He knows. So they were happy with this answer when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنِّي أَعْلَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam. And as an honor to Adam alayhi salam, He created him with His own two hands. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala physically created Adam alayhi salam with His own two hands. And as we know, Adam alayhi salam was created from dirt. And where did this dirt come from? The dirt that Adam alayhi salam was created from was dirt from the earth. From the earth. We said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the earth before. And He sent Jibreel alayhi salam down to the earth to collect dirt to make Adam alayhi salam. So Jibreel alayhi salam came down to the earth. And he was going to start collecting the dirt. And then the earth said to Jibreel alayhi salam, A'udhu billahi mink. I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from you coming and taking dirt from me. So when he said A'udhu billah, when the earth said A'udhu billah, Jibreel alayhi salam, he didn't take anything and he went back. And he told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the earth sought refuge in you from what I was going to do. So I left. I didn't do it. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent another angel. He sent Mika'il to do the same thing. So Mika'il came down and he was going to collect the dirt from the earth. And the earth said the same thing. A'udhu billah. I seek refuge in Allah from what you are trying to do. So Mika'il, he went back. And he told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the earth sought refuge in you from me taking dirt from it, so I left it and I came back. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Malakul Maut, the angel of death. He sent the angel of death down to the earth to complete this job, this task of collecting the dirt. And the earth said the same thing to him, A'udhu billah, I seek refuge in Allah from what you are trying to do, taking dirt from my surface. And then the angel of death replied him back, and I seek refuge in Allah from not fulfilling His command. He commanded me to come and take dirt from you, and I seek refuge in Allah from not fulfilling His command. So he went and he collected the dirt. The Malakul Maut, the angel of death, he collected the dirt from the earth for the creation of Adam alayhi salam. Now he didn't collect dirt from only one part of the earth. Rather, he went all around the earth and he collected dirt from different places. And he collected different kinds of dirt of different colors. He collected some white dirt, some black dirt, some red dirt, and different colors in between. And that is why from the descendants of Adam alayhi salam, you will find people of all colors. You will find white people, you will find black people, and you will find other colors in between. And that is because the asl, the original creation of Adam alayhi salam, was from dirt that was from all parts of the earth, and that dirt was composed of different colors. So that's why the descendants of Adam alayhi salam have different colors today. And we all come from Adam alayhi salam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He molded Adam alayhi salam, He created him with His own two hands, and then He told the angels, when I blow my breath into Adam alayhi salam, then you all do sujood to him. You all make sujood to him. And this sujood was not sujood of worship, of course, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone is the only one who is worthy of worship. But this sujood or this prostration was a prostration to show respect to Adam alayhi salam and to obey the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was not a sujood, it was not a prostration of worship. And now in our religion of Al-Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained that we make sujood, we make sajda, prostration only to Him alone. And we don't make prostration to any creation for any reason at all. Not to show honor, not to show respect, nothing. You don't bow down before a king, you don't bow down before the president, no. Sujood, prostration is only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But during that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained for his angels to bow down to Adam alayhi salam, to prostrate before Adam alayhi salam as a sign of respect, not as a sign of worship. So he told them, when I breathe into him, then go down into sajda as a sign of respect for Adam alayhi salam. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala breathed into Adam alayhi salam and Adam alayhi salam became alive, then the angels did as they were commanded to do. They all went down into prostration to Adam alayhi salam as commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, except Iblis. Iblis did not bow down to Adam alayhi salam. Iblis did not obey the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now if you look at the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressed this command of making prostration to Adam alayhi salam. He addressed this command to the angels. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمْ. When your Lord told the malaika, he told the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. فَسَجَدُوا. So they prostrated. إِلَّا Iblis. Except Iblis. Now Iblis, he was not from the angels. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the angels to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam. But Iblis, even though he was not an angel, he was from the jinn, he was also included in that commandment. And the mufassireen, the ulama have said, Iblis was included in the commandment to bow down to Adam alayhi salam along with the malaika, because Iblis, due to his obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had reached a position like he was with the malaika. Iblis, due to his obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his knowledge and his obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he had reached a position with the angels. This is Iblis. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, whatever good Iblis did in the past, it was all destroyed because of the arrogance of Iblis. So whatever good, whatever obedience Iblis had to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, such obedience that propelled him to the level of the angels, it was all destroyed because of his envy and his jealousy and his arrogance. And this is something that we should take stock of. We may have many good deeds, but it can all be destroyed in an instant if we are arrogant and if we deny the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what Iblis did. When all of the angels went down into prostration as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded them to do, Iblis refused. He didn't go down. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, قَالَ مَا مَنَعَكَ. What prevented you from making sajda when I ordered you to do so? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him. And then Iblis said, قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ. I am better than him. Why should I make sajda to him? I am better than him. خَلَقْتَنِي مِنْ نَارٍ وَخَلَقْتَهُ مِنْ طِينٍ. You made me out of fire, and you made him out of mud, out of dirt. So Iblis thought that fire is better than dirt. So he thought, because he was created from fire, and Adam alayhi salam was created from dirt, he said, أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِّنْ. I am better than him. So why should I make sajda to him when he is inferior to me? So he denied the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of envy and out of kibr, out of arrogance. So this was the first sin ever committed. The first sin ever committed. And that was the sin of Iblis. And it was a sin of arrogance, a sin of kibr. So next time we want to be arrogant or we want to deny a commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of our kibr, because of our arrogance, let us remember that this was the first sin of Iblis. And we don't want to follow in his footsteps with arrogance. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all humility to accept the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and never deny them. So Iblis's arrogance, it destroyed all of his worship and all of his good deeds that he had accumulated in the past that had put him to the level of the malaika. And he was destroyed in this instant by his refusal to submit to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Iblis refused to follow this commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala banished him from Jannah. قَالَ فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا فَإِنَّكَ رَجِيمٌ. Get out of here. Get out of Jannah. Surely you are accursed. Then Iblis replied to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَالَ رَبِّ فَأَنْظِرْنِي إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. O Allah, O my Lord, give me a chance. Give me respite until يوم القيامة. Let me go until يوم القيامة. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قَالَ فَإِنَّكَ مِنَ الْمُنْظَرِينَ. He said, okay, I will give you respite until يوم القيامة. And the ulama have said from this that even the dua of the shaytan, of Iblis, was accepted. Iblis, after committing such a big sin and refusing to follow the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make sajda to Adam alayhi salam, immediately after committing this sin, Iblis made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rabbi, فَأَنْظِرْنِي إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. He called to Allah, oh my Lord, give me a chance until يوم القيامة. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted and answered his dua. قَالَ فَإِنَّكَ مِنَ الْمُنْظَرِينَ. He said, you are from those who have been given respite. So this shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even accepted the dua of the shaytan. So how can you or I, when we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, think that our dua is not going to be accepted, when he even accepted the dua of the shaytan? So yes, there are cases where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he accepts the dua of a non-Muslim, of a kafir even. In this case, he accepted the dua even of shaytan himself. So we should make sure that we continue to always call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask him for our needs, because he is the one who listens to dua and he accepts dua. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here accepted the dua of the shaytan and he gave him respite, he gave him a chance until يوم القيامة. So the shaytan, after having his dua accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he went further into evil and misguidance. And he said that he has made it his goal in his life to mislead the people. He said, لَأَقْعُدَنَّ لَهُمْ صِرَاطَكَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. He told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I am going to make people go astray from your straight path, from the Sirat al-Mustaqim. My goal in my life, I'm going to make people get off the straight path. ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِلِهِمْ وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. He said, I'm going to come to them from the front and the back and the right and the left, and you will find that most of them will not be thankful. So he said this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in such an arrogant and bold way, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his dua and granted him respite up to Yawm al-Qiyamah. So we should realize from this part of the story that shaytan, Iblis, is our sworn enemy. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us that many times. Inna shaytana lakum aduwwum mubeen. Surely the shaytan is your clear enemy. Inna shaytana lakum aduwwun fattakhidhuhu aduwwa. Surely the shaytan is your enemy, so take him as your enemy. Treat him like he is your enemy, because he is your enemy. He hated Adam alayhi salam, and he was jealous of our father Adam alayhi salam. So he became the enemy of mankind. So now that we know he is our enemy, and he has been our enemy since the beginning, since our father Adam alayhi salam, we know the shaitan is our enemy. Yet still we obey him, yet still we follow in his footsteps, yet still we listen to his whispers, and we do what he tells us to do. This doesn't make sense when we know the shaitan is our enemy and his goal in his life is to take us with him to his final abode of Jahannam. We cannot obey him. He is our enemy, and whatever he tells us to do is because he wants us to be destroyed. So let us take the shaitan as our enemy. Let us treat him as our enemy, and let us seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the accursed shaitan. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, and the shaitan swore that he was going to misguide Adam alayhi salam and his progeny and his descendants, and he made this his purpose in life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, and he created his wife for him, and he allowed them to enjoy Jannah. They were free to enjoy everything in Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made everything in Jannah halal for them. Except one thing, one tree. He said, you can enjoy everything in Jannah. Whatever you like, enjoy it. But just stay away from this one tree. That was just one command. Stay away from this one tree and enjoy everything else. So they did that. They enjoyed Jannah. They were happy. They were happy with each other's company. They were happy with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah. They enjoyed the fruits of Jannah. They enjoyed the shade of Jannah. They were very happy. And then the shaitan came with his cunning tricks. The shaitan tried to get Adam alayhi salam and his wife to do that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade them from doing. He tried to convince them to go to that tree and eat from that tree. And he told them that if you eat from this tree, then you will become angels or you will live forever. He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't tell you to stay away from that tree, except that if you take from that tree, if you eat from that tree, you will become angels or you will live forever. He tried to convince them in this way. He tried to tell them that it would be in their benefit to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and eat from this tree. And this was the first lie. The Iblis telling Adam alayhi salam and his wife that if you eat from this tree, you will become angels or you will live forever. Iblis, he lied. And this was the first lie. So when we lie, we should remember that Iblis is the one who invented this practice of lying. And we don't want to follow in his footsteps. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always make us truthful. Yet still, Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they didn't listen to Iblis. They stayed firm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us not to eat from this tree. We're not going to eat it. And they didn't do it. The shaitan kept persisting and trying from different ways to convince them to eat from this tree. That shows his enmity towards Adam alayhi salam and humankind in general. Finally, وَقَاسَمَهُمَا إِنِّي لَكُمَا لَمِنَ النَّاصِحِينَ. Then finally he swore by Allah. He took an oath by Allah, Iblis. He swore by Allah that he was being truthful and that he sincerely wanted good for Adam alayhi salam and his wife to go and eat from that tree. He lied and he swore by Allah in that lie. And this is the first instance, again, of somebody swearing by Allah and lying in that oath. And Adam alayhi salam, when Iblis said this, when Iblis swore by Allah that he was sincere and that he was only telling them this for their own good, then Adam alayhi salam, out of his innocence, he thought that it's impossible. Nobody can swear by Allah and then tell a lie. He thought to himself, this cannot be. Nobody would swear by Allah and then tell a lie. So he went ahead and ate from that tree, him and his wife, Adam alayhi salam and Hawa. They ate from the tree. And once they ate from that tree, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called upon them, أَلَمْ أَنْهَكُمَا عَنْ تِلْكُمَ الشَّجَرَةِ وَأَقُلْ لَكُمَا إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمَا عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. He said to them, didn't I tell you to stay away from that tree? And didn't I tell you that shaitan is your clear enemy? Then they realized their mistake. They realized they did something wrong by going against the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But look at their reaction and compare it to the reaction of Iblis. Iblis was arrogant. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him why he didn't bow down to Adam alayhi salam, he was arrogant and he said, I'm better than him. I'm not going to bow down. But look at the reaction of Adam alayhi salam and his wife when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala admonished them for eating from the tree that he had forbidden them to eat from. قَالَا رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَّمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Immediately, they said, oh, our Lord, we have wronged ourselves. And if you don't forgive us and if you don't have mercy on us, then surely we will be from the losers. See the difference in the reaction. Iblis, he was arrogant. While Adam alayhi salam and his wife, even though they made a mistake, they were humble and they admitted to their mistake and they begged Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. So all of us in our lives, we're all going to make mistakes, we're all going to commit sins. But when we commit a sin, let us not react like Iblis reacted. Rather, let us react like Adam alayhi salam and his wife reacted. Today you see sometimes someone is committing a sin, he's doing something wrong. And when he is advised that this is haram, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't allow this, he tries to find a way to justify his sin. He tries to find a way to justify it. Instead of admitting, yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this, I accept it, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his forgiveness. No, rather we find people today, when you tell them this is not allowed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will find some type of way to get around the prohibition. They will try to play games and they will try to find loopholes to disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wal'iyadhu billah. This is the way of the shaitan. Justifying your sin may be worse than the original sin in the first place. Never try to justify disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us will disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at one point or another. We are human beings, we are sinners, and we admit that. But when we are confronted with our sins and when we realize we committed a sin, let our reaction be like the reaction of Adam alayhi salam. And let us say, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. O Allah, O our Lord, surely we have wronged ourselves, and if you don't forgive us and if you don't have mercy on us, surely we will be from the losers. This should be our reaction whenever we commit a sin. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness for our sins. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted their repentance. He accepted the repentance of Adam alayhi salam and his wife because they were sincere in their repentance. They made a mistake, they sincerely repented, they had regret for what they did, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave them. But now their time on earth had to begin. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took them out of Jannah and he put them on the earth. And that was the reason why he created them in the first place, for them to inhabit the earth. So now their time on earth began. After eating from that tree, they were sent out of Jannah to inhabit the earth. And it has been narrated that in heaven, Musa alayhi salam and Adam alayhi salam had an argument. And Musa alayhi salam said, you are Adam. You are the one that because of you, we were kicked out of Jannah and sent to the earth. And then Adam alayhi salam said to Musa alayhi salam, you are Musa, the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised up with his message and by speaking to him directly. How can you blame me for something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had already written before he even created me? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had written that earth is going to be our place of inhabitants, and he wrote that down before he even created me. So how are you going to blame me for that? So Musa alayhi salam couldn't say anything. So Adam alayhi salam, he won this argument, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned. So then his time on earth began. And of course, earth is not like Jannah. On earth, you have to work, you have to earn your living, and the life is not as easy as the life of Jannah. But Adam alayhi salam, alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him even on earth, and he gave him a good life. And he gave him companionship of his wife, and he gave them children. And Adam alayhi salam and his wife, they were given two sets of twins as children. The first set of twins was a boy and a girl. The boy, his name was Qabil, and he was born with a twin sister. Then after some time, they were blessed with another set of twins. Again, a boy and a girl. The boy's name was Habil, and he was born with his sister. So two sets of twins, a boy and a girl. When these children grew up and they became older, of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made in the innate nature of a man that he wants companionship, he wants to be married. A man, he feels the need for having a woman companion, and a woman, she feels the need for having a man as her companion. And this is the fitrah, this is the nature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in human beings. So after some time, the sons of Adam alayhi salam, Qabil and Habil, they felt this need to get married. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Adam alayhi salam to marry each son with the opposite sister, not with the sister that he was born with, but with the sister that came with the other set of twins. So Qabil was ordered to marry the sister that came with Habil, and Habil was ordered to marry the sister that came with Qabil. So they were ordered to marry the opposite set of sisters. Now, the twin sister of Qabil, the one that came with Qabil, she was very beautiful. She was more beautiful than the sister that came with Habil. So Qabil, he didn't like this ordainment. He wanted to marry his own twin sister. And he wanted Habil to marry his own twin sister. He didn't want to do the cross marriage, because the sister that he was born with was more attractive and more beautiful. So he went against the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them a solution, and he ordered both of them to offer a sacrifice. And whoever's sacrifice is accepted, that one will marry the beautiful sister. So they both offered their sacrifices. Now, Qabil, he was a cultivator. He was a farmer, and he used to raise crops. And Habil, he used to raise animals. He used to raise cattle. So Qabil, he gave a sacrifice of some of his crops. And Habil, he gave a sacrifice of an animal. And the sacrifice of Habil was accepted, and the sacrifice of Qabil was not accepted. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from the muttaqeen. He accepts from the people who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and keep their duty towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now Qabil, he was rejecting the instructions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the beginning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him to marry the sister that was born with Habil, but he didn't want to do this. He didn't want to submit to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he was not from the muttaqeen. He was not from the people who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and kept their duty towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he was from the muttaqeen, then there would not even be any need for this test. He would have accepted what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded from the beginning. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him this test, and he wasn't sincere. Qabil was not sincere, so his sacrifice was not accepted, while his brother's was accepted. And then he said to his brother out of jealousy, he said, قَالَ لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ. I'm going to kill you. Because he didn't want to see his brother marrying the woman that he wanted to marry himself. He didn't want to see his brother happy while he himself was not happy. So he had this envy and he had this jealousy in him. And he said that he was going to kill his brother. And his brother was very sincere towards him. Habil wanted good for his brother Qabil. He was a pious man. He was from the muttaqeen. And he tried to turn him back to the Sirat al-Mustaqim. He tried to guide him back to the straight path. And he advised him to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you don't obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you commit these sins, then you will be from the people of the fire. You don't want to be from the people of the fire. He admonished him, he advised him. And he loved good for his brother. He wanted good for his brother. But it all fell on deaf ears. And eventually, Qabil, he carried out his threat and he murdered his brother Habil. He murdered him. And this was the first murder in the history of mankind. The first murder in the history of mankind. The murder of Qabil to his brother Habil. Qabil murdered Habil. And it is for this reason that if a person kills anyone, if somebody unjustly murders another person, it is as if he killed all of humanity. And a portion of that sin, whenever anybody commits murder, a portion of that sin, it goes to Qabil. Because he is the one who invented murder. He is the one who invented murder. So anytime anyone commits murder, he is following the sunnah of Qabil. And Qabil, he takes a piece of that punishment. So imagine, the amount of sins he has accumulated from the beginning of time, from when he murdered his brother up to now. How many people have been murdered over the course of history? And he is taking a portion of that sin. وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. So we should take a lesson from this. If we invent something bad, if we start a new sin and people follow us in that, then we are going to take a piece of the burden and a piece of the punishment on Yawm al-Qiyamah. مَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً حَسَنَةً فَلَهُ أَجْرُهَا وَأَجْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. Whoever starts a good thing that is in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, whoever revives a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ in accordance with Islam, then inshallah this person will have the reward for that and the reward for whoever acts on that up to Yawm al-Qiyamah. But on the other hand, وَمَنْ سَنَّ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ سُنَّةً سَيِّئَةً فَعَلَيْهِ وِزْرُهَا وَوِزْرُ مَنْ عَمِلَ بِهَا إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. But whoever starts a bad practice, whoever innovates something evil, and the people follow him in that, he will have the punishment or the burden of that, and the burden of everyone who follows him in that up to يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. So this is something very dangerous. We want to make sure we never start something bad that people follow us in doing that, because we may take a portion of the sin without even realizing what we are accumulating. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe from that. So Qabil, he murdered his brother and he started the sunnah of murder in humanity. And this was such an evil action, and Qabil didn't know what to do with the dead body of his brother. This was a new thing. We have a dead body here. How am I supposed to dispose of it? What should I do? Should I just leave it here? What should I do? He didn't know what to do. Now Qabil, because he did such an evil thing, he was not worthy of receiving any revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah sends revelation to people to honor them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent ilham and wahi to his prophets, to his messengers, as an honor to them. And even the good people, the Salihin, they may get good dreams from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as an honor to them. But Qabil, he was not deserving of this honor to receive any type of revelation or any type of ilham or any type of wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was not deserving of this honor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But his brother Habil, he was deserving for a proper burial. He was a good man, and he deserved to be treated in a good way even after his death. So how did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose to teach Qabil to dispose of his brother without honoring him with any type of revelation, but with keeping the honor of his dead brother? He sent a crow, a black crow, two black crows, to teach Qabil how to treat the body of his dead brother. Two black crows. And one of them killed the other one. One crow killed the other crow. And after it had killed the other crow, it dug a hole in the ground and it buried the other crow. So Qabil, he saw this and he felt very sad when he saw this. He said, this is a crow and I am a human being and I have to learn how to dispose of the body of my brother from a crow. So he realized and he felt ashamed at himself at that moment, that even a crow knows better than him. And he felt humiliated and he felt regretful. فَأَصْبَحَ مِنَ النَّادِمِينَ. And he felt regret at that. So we see here that there are many lessons that we can learn from these stories. First lesson, stay away from kibr, stay away from arrogance. Arrogance is what destroyed the shaitan. Even though he was an obedient slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he had reached the level of the malaika, his arrogance and his envy towards Adam alayhi salam destroyed all of that, cancelled out all his good deeds, and he is from the people or from the inhabitants of Jahannam. And he's going to try to bring as many people with him to join him in Jahannam. The second lesson we need to take is that the shaitan is our clear enemy. The shaitan is our enemy and he's going to do whatever he can to try to misguide us. And he will use tricky techniques and methods to try to misguide you. If he's not able to do it in one way, if he sees that's not working, he's going to try it from another angle, and another angle, and another angle. He's going to keep trying, and keep trying. But we have to continually ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe from the plots and the tricks of the shaitan. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the shaitan, إِنَّ عِبَادِي لَيْسَ لَكَ عَلَيْهِمْ سُلْطَانِ إِلَّا مَنِ اتَّبَعَكَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. Surely my servants, you have no power over them, except those people who follow you from the misguided people. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among His servants that the shaitan has no power and no authority over. So let us realize, shaitan has been our enemy from day one. From the creation of Adam alayhi salam to now, he is our enemy. And his sole purpose in life is to misguide us and take him to Jahannam with him. So let us keep this in mind, let us keep focus on this point, and don't obey the shaitan no matter what he tells you to do. Obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and stay away from the whispers of the shaitan. Also, we have to learn the importance of submission to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Qabil was ordered to marry the twin sister of Habil. And this was a commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But instead of saying sami'na wa ata'na, he said, no, I don't want to do it. He didn't submit to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look what his final destination is. He is someone who is going to take the sin of every murder that ever happens in the course of humanity. And he's going to have a portion of that. Just because he wouldn't submit to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us take a lesson from this, that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us to do something, our response should be, sami'na wa ata'na. We hear and we obey. Even if it's something we like or we dislike, it doesn't matter. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us to do it, then we have no choice in the matter. We have no say in the matter. And we submit 100% to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another lesson that we gain from this story is when we commit a sin and we are confronted with that sin, we admit to that sin and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately for forgiveness, and we don't try to justify our disobedience. As Adam alayhi salam and his wife did, they immediately said, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh, our Lord, we have wronged ourselves, and if you don't forgive us, if you don't have mercy on us, we will surely be from the losers. This should be our attitude whenever we realize we have committed a sin. Let's not be like Iblis and show arrogance. Rather, let us be like Adam alayhi salam and his wife and show regret and remorse and make tawbah and istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for all of our sins. So these are some of the lessons that we can gain from the story of Adam alayhi salam, his time in Jannah, the shaitan's misguidance and the shaitan's plot to take mankind with him to Jahannam. And we can also learn lessons from Adam alayhi salam and his wife repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we can learn the lesson of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the story of Qabil and his brother Habil. Let us be like Habil, who was quick to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was from the muttaqeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his sacrifice from him. Why? Because he was from the muttaqeen. إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Surely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts from the muttaqeen. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all among the muttaqeen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all among the people who obey him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all among the people who are aware of the plots of the shaitan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from those plots. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala eventually give us Jannah back again. Let us be joined with our father Adam alayhi salam and the prophets and the siddiqeen and the shuhada and the salihin in Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all of this. Ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.